This is The Unseen, and I'm your host, Mike Clelland. The guest on this episode is Lance Munguia, and he directed the feature-length documentary Third Eye Spies. And this is really a good, in-depth study. This is not a fluffy overview. This is an in-depth study of the remote viewing program that was run some decades ago. And the film is mostly focused on Russell Targ. And he played a leading role in not only in the film, but in the program that was run out of SRI, which is the Stanford Research Institute. And they were doing some secret work trying to understand and weaponize these psychic skills, these remote viewing skills. A lot of talk about spies, a lot of talk about the CIA, and it's quite a wonderful film. We ended up talking about a lot more than just the film. We went all over the map and talked about meditation and talked about the UFO stuff a lot, actually showed up. And there's a few points in the audio where I kind of misspoke. And then what I did is I just plugged back in a little segment where I corrected myself. So you'll hear that in the interview. This interview was recorded in March of 2019. Please enjoy. Lance, I want to thank you so much for saying yes to this interview. It means a lot to me.
Oh, Mike, thank you so much for having me. It means a lot to me to be here.
Good. You just finished a film. It's called Third Eye Spy, and it follows Russell Targ. I guess he would be the central character. And very early on in the film, it's within the first few minutes, there's a scene where Russell is in a cemetery, and he speaks very, you know, solemnly and says, "This may be the last chance to tell our story." And that's how the movie began. So to set it up that way, really, really, you know, I was pulled in. Let me put it that way.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. And yeah, that was kind of the thing that pulled me in as well. You know, I mean, I when I first sort of sat down with Russell and we talked about making a movie about the 20-year history of the military's use of psychics, for lack of a better word, for as remote viewers, the thing that was on our minds the most was being able to preserve these people's accounts firsthand before they, before they passed on. I mean, you know, because when we started this, Ingo Swann, who was one of their best remote viewers, had just passed away a year earlier. So it was really very much on Russell's mind was his own mortality and the mortality of the other players that were involved. And we wanted to talk to them while they were still, you know, really able to tell the complete story. And so we had that kind of a window after it being declassified and, you know, the time to make the film. So the mortality really kind of, to me, became kind of a theme, you know, in the film, is to, you know, just sort of just get this story out, you know, because it was very important, I think, to everybody that was involved that the story be preserved. And it wasn't about just Russell Targ or just one or two people, you know, that were involved with these government programs. It was the collective weight of everybody being in sort of one documented place. And that's the thing that I felt was the most important, because the more I heard about this stuff, the more it was so shocking and so unbelievable. I really felt the only way that it would make sense for people was to have all of the very credible players that had been involved on camera. And so we managed to do that. And I'm glad that, you know, we were able to preserve that history.
Yeah, it was remarkable. And, you know, so the movie is, you know, slick, you know, it's kind of zippy the way it's edited. And at the same time, it's very thoughtful and very straight and very grounded. And that was appreciated by me, because I watch a lot of documentaries and I'm just my heart sinks when they turn into kind of exploitative entertainment.
Yeah. And that was another thing that I spent months doing, you know, background interviews with some of the players and exchanging emails and, you know, writing these, you know, very long emails back and forth, you know, with people like Joe McMonagle and Ken Kress and Kit Green and, you know, some of the players that were involved, to really convince them that this was going to be a serious look at their work and that this was not just a sensational kind of a flash in the pan. It was just designed to kind of elicit, you know, whatever short-term response got the best reaction. And, you know, for me, again, it was just so much about preserving the history. And at the same time, I did tons and tons and tons of screenings of this for both audiences that were aware of this kind of topic matter, like, you know, the IRVA, you know, International Remote Viewing Association conference, or the SSE conference, you know, places like that, or just people who knew nothing about this. And what I found was it is challenging to put a whole bunch of PhD scientists in a film and then remain invested in that for, you know, close to 2 hours of time. And so I developed this kind of a hybrid style, you know, where it you know, using a lot of the old kind of archival looking footage, and the kind of looks of this, you know, things that sort of kept the audience kind of moving and making it snappy enough that it really moved, and it kept your attention the whole time, because that was really a challenge, you know, because it can be such a weighty subject. When you're talking about, you know, 20 years of remote viewing data, you know, that had a lot of which never been talked about before publicly. And a lot of the scientists like Russell, you know, who was also the producer on the film, would say, no, but we also need to put in this other example and this other example, and you need to show a longer, you know, example of remote viewing. And my argument would always be, you know, like once you've seen a miracle and you can accept that the miracle's real, you don't have to detail out every, you know, other miracle that ever happened. It's like people understand that it's possible, and then you can kind of just go to the highlights, because it was so much information. I literally could have made 3 or 4 completely different versions of Third Eye Spies, and all of them would have been interesting.
Hey, so you as far as the sophisticated audience, the people listening right now are about as sophisticated as you're going to find as far as having a very good working knowledge of this end of the esoteric spectrum. Now, that said, could you give like a little elevator spiel about, you know, what remote viewing is?
Sure. Remote viewing is the act of using only your mind to explore things, people, places, even emotional context of people, outside of space and time, to see things that are otherwise hidden. And, you know, this is an ability that we all have. You know, it's part of our own natural intuitive ability. And some people may be really great at it. You know, other people may just be able to kind of carry a tune with it. But the act of being able to use your intuition to see things that are otherwise hidden is part of our birthright. It's part of the reason that you and I are standing here, or sitting here, I should say, doing this interview when someone else isn't, because our ancestors knew to go left instead of right to avoid that tiger that would have eaten them, you know, or whatever. It's just part of who we are.
I agree. Yeah. Or that it would have been, you know, like the shaman in the village would really have had magical abilities, or what we would call magical abilities now.
Yes.
And that would have been normal to have a shaman in the village. It does not seem normal now to have a medicine man or a mystic or a, I guess, you know, the fortune teller, you know, with the neon light on her door in the, you know, outskirts of town. We still have that in our present day, and that's dismissed outright by a lot of folks. And also, to take that on, I've read two of Joe McMonagle's books, and a lot of the book was talking about how frustrating it was to be taken seriously within the framework of the armed forces, you know, doing this psychic work.
Yes, and that's really the largest, I think, problem that this whole field of study has, is that because it seems so unbelievable, people don't ever like to feel like they've been conned. And that includes myself. I mean, I'm sure it includes you too. It's like, you know, your discernment is very important, but we tend to slip into this kind of dogmatic skepticism when there's something that we don't really understand, because it's easier, because it's like, well, you're not going to fool me with this. And part of, I think, SRI's success in remote viewing is the fact that walking into a major scientific laboratory, one of the biggest, you know, scientific laboratories for doing classified work in the world, and then having very legitimate scientists with PhDs after their names say, okay, psychic abilities are real. We understand you've never done this before, but you're going to sit down in the chair and you're going to be the psychic today. And they would do this again and again, and they would get great results. On the other hand, they had these very dogmatic skeptics. I mean, a really quick story about Joe McMonagle Joe McMonagle was the Army's sort of most famous remote viewer. He won a Legion of Merit Award, which is the highest award you can get as a non-combatant in the U.S. military, for something like, 250 missions used remote viewing to get information they otherwise could not. And he told a story that I actually haven't shared on air before, that at one point, someone else at his base in Fort Meade pulled him into a broom closet and put a gun to his head and said, "You're going to tell us exactly how it is that you're faking what you're doing and how you're getting this done, or we're going to blow your head off." because basically even his own colleagues in the intelligence community did not trust where he was getting his information from. I'm sure not all of them, but there was somebody there obviously on his base that was convinced that he was somehow a Soviet agent or, somehow pulling the wool over people's eyes. And this was a common thread, not to that maybe extent, but they constantly had this sort of a giggle factor working against them, where people just would refuse to take them seriously, no matter how much great information they were able to pull out of the air.
And then there's the secrecy, bubble that must surround everything they're doing that you would make it impossible for him to give that answer, like with the gun to his head, I guess.
That's right. That's right. And that actually has been the bane of this entire field of study, in terms of psychic research for the last, at least since the 60s, 70s, is that the very best work was not being done publicly. It was being done in classified circles. And it was being done through a process using the remote government, the U.S. government, which could verify remote viewings in a way that nobody else on the planet could, because they had satellites and they had human intelligence and they had other assets to back up what someone in a room at Fort Meade or in a laboratory at SRI was saying. So you had all of this great work being done, and yet you had scientists like Russell and even people like Dean Radin and Hal Puthoff and so many others that could talk about it, but they had to talk about it in very sort of not definitive ways. And that really allowed the skeptics, I think, to really pounce on this subject matter and belittle it for a long time, because we were arguing over very small things. And the really big things that these people were seeing couldn't even be discussed until now.
And I suspect that you must have run into this while making the film, where I'm certain, and I would expect there to be, things that they cannot talk about to this day.
Absolutely. Hal Puthoff, I asked Hal, I spent 3 days with Hal Puthoff in his lab at Austin and kind of just followed him around. And I asked him at one point, how much of this stuff do you think is still not released to the public? And he said probably 70%. That's a lot.
And that would have been somewhere my guess to over half, sure. And I'm just guessing just this. The government seems to love to stamp things top secret. So,
well, originally this entire program was marked automatic do not downgrade, by CIA. Because normally stuff gets declassified. I think it's after 20 years or 25 years. And Russell had been waiting for that sort of clock to tick out, and he wanted to write a book on the subject. And other people had leaked things, illegally, but Russell didn't want to do that. And it was marked automatic do not downgrade. He saw the files and he said, "Oh my gosh, they're never going to release this." And it took, a lot of people lobbying former allies that they had in Congress and, things like that for the stuff to finally get trickled out, over time. And I think once the stuff started coming out, then I think they actually really opened the floodgate and they let out a lot of documents. I suspect that's probably because CIA and other agencies figured if there's a whole bunch of information that people have to kind of wade through, it's not as easy to see the really good stuff. That's what I think.
Did you get a chance to talk with Jim Mars at all before he died?
I met Jim Mars once at a conference, and I did not. I've read some of his stuff, but I was not able to speak with him. I know he was one of the earliest, sort of documenters of a lot of the Army program, interviewing people like Joe and Lynn Buchanan and people like that, which actually, funny enough, have been the most accessible out of all of the people that were originally involved, because I think because those guys were not career intelligence people, they were Army guys, that had been doing intelligence, but then got out of the Army. And I think we're much more open to talking about this. So, you know, but no, I wish I had been able to really interview Jim Mars more, but I wasn't able to.
Yeah, I spoke to him and did an interview with him, oh, I don't know, just must have been 6+ years ago, maybe 7 years ago. And he talked about, and he's been very public about this, and he talked about the fact that he produced a book. And he had a, the book was all done, all ready to go to the press. And then for some reason, which you can guess what that might be, this was a book on the remote viewing program. I think it was called Spies. It was later released in its a little bit amended format, or over a decade after it was originally proposed to be published. The publisher, a great big publisher, contacted him and said, "Oh, we're not going to publish the book, but we're going to pay you in full."
Wow.
And he says that's never happened to him before. So he got paid off and the book never got published. And then shortly thereafter, I can't remember who it was. I'm drawing a blank now. And I should know this. But someone from within the program put out a kind of watered down book of their own on the subject. And his sense was that the secret keepers wanted to manage and control how the information got out.
Hi, this is Mike. I am chiming in during the editing process. I came back in to amend something because I misspoke. I made a mistake about one point, and I want to correct it here. I want to clarify this. In the interview, I said that someone from within the program published their own book shortly after Jim Mars, that his book was canceled. That's incorrect. The book Jim Mars wrote was canceled in July of 1995. And according to Jim, everyone involved in the work came to believe that this cancellation had been ordered by someone, and this is a quote from him, ordered by someone with great authority. 4 months later, after that cancellation, the CIA acknowledged remote viewing, and they did this in a news release. Now, this received superficial coverage in both the New York Times and the Washington Post. And this is a direct quote from Jim. And although it was announced publicly, the story was essentially dismissed in the mainstream press. Jim's book was later published 5 years later in 2010 under the title Psy Spies. And that book got amended and updated and republished again in 2007. Okay, I just needed to clarify that. Back to the interview.
Yeah, and you find that again and again. You know, this subject matter is consistently marginalized in the media, you know, in circles. You know, I think recently it's become a little bit easier because I think that probably a lot of the older secret keepers have probably moved on and are not involved in the agencies anymore. And I think that a lot of times when it comes to covert stuff, the left hand doesn't know what the right hand is doing. You know, they're so compartmentalized in these different programs. You know, even when it came to interviewing someone like Ken Kress, who was our, you know, who was the undercover physicist that was originally the first program monitor from CIA that at the inception of the remote viewing program with SRI.
Hold on, I got to interrupt. What is an undercover physicist?
Well, an undercover physicist would have been a person who, you know, he was a nuclear physicist or something. I mean, he was some kind of a physicist, and nobody knew that he was associated with CIA. So if he was going out and making some sort of connection with SRI, nobody would know that it was coming from CIA. They would think it was just one physicist talking to another physicist. That was the sort of the CIA's idea in appointing Ken, you know, to oversee the program. You know, it was actually Sid Gottlieb of MK Ultra fame who recommended Ken, you know, to be involved. And he said, you know, well, you're a physicist and I'm sure you can talk, you know, physicist stuff to these other guys at SRI and oversee this. But nobody knew that Ken was in CIA or that CIA was overseeing this. So he was completely undercover, and actually his name had never been released or come forward, you know, and he'd never done any real interviews for, you know, until our film, you know, really. You know, he had written some articles within intelligence circles, talking about the findings when the program, you know, once the stuff had been declassified, but he never actually gave an interview or came forward. So, but because people like that, you know, Ken had to go to CIA to get all of his questions cleared, you know, for the documentary. So he had stuff.
So the questions that you were going to ask him needed to be cleared.
Right.
Okay.
Questions that I was going to be asking him. I submitted a list, and then he also included his own list of things to be talked about. And, you know, they all came back approved. He did say there was an additional list that he tried to get declassified that he was not able to because it had not been declassified yet. So there were some things he couldn't talk about. And I don't know what they were because he couldn't talk about them. But I was amazed at how much was cleared. And what it suggested to me is that the guy sitting in the clearance office at CIA probably knows nothing about the remote viewing program, because they released some pretty cool stuff to us that nobody knew about, like the fact that there were other CIA agents being uptrained to be remote viewers. There were other, sort of missions that they had gone on internally within CIA after or around the time of remote viewer Pat Price's death, you know, who was killed or passed away shortly before, all of that had occurred. So long story short, I think that the U.S. intelligence agencies back then, when Jim Mars was trying to publish his first book, it was still probably closer. Do you know what year that was?
I could look it up. I would have to look it up. I'm guessing it would have been in the early 90s.
Yeah, so if it was early 90s, it's before this whole thing even really was declassified, and he was talking primarily to the Army guys. The one vibe that I got from the CIA people we spoke with when talking about the Army guys was that they didn't like the Army guys. You know, they did not like the Army remote viewing program, and in fact, the head of CIA intentionally would go out of his way to consistently denigrate the Army program, when it came to congressional meetings and things like that, because my feeling is that the Army guys just weren't lifelong intelligence people. You know, you had people trying to get movie deals and trying to, you know, write books and go out and speak to people like Jim Mars. I'm sure he was probably at the center of that at the time before all of this came out. And that led to a lot of hand-wringing within CIA and other agencies that were still using this. You know, because even as the CIA was denigrating the Army program, they were using the Army program. And they were also using other aspects of remote viewing that weren't in the Army, like people at SRI and other consultants that they also had brought in by that point that were not SRI. So the bottom line is, my feeling is that probably the Army program was killed on the vine. And Dale Graff, the head of the DIA, program at Fort Meade, you know, he has told me that he felt like towards the end of the program in the early 90s, before this sort of all came out, they were being choked off. They were no longer being given sort of the really good assignments. They had absolutely no funding for basic amenities and things like, you know, in their unit. And I really think they were being punished because you had Army grunts who were getting out and talking about this because it was incredible, and they were trying to cash in on it. And even in the film, you know, Dale says, he had gone to Jack Verona, who was the head of DIA, and he said, "What are we supposed to do about these people who are leaking all this information out?" And Verona said, "Do nothing. You know, do not engage them in any way. Let them say whatever they want. People will think they're crazy, and life goes on." You know, and it wasn't until, you know, President Carter came out and started talking about it inadvertently at a talk at Emory University, that finally triggered DIA to hand things back to CIA and then officially cancel the program. So I really think that was sort of the emphasis for that was just the fact that you had a lot of kind of people talking.
Yeah. Hey, we will need to take a short break. For non-members, there will be a few commercials, but for paying members, we'll be right back.
This is Whitley Strieber. I'm going to be attending two conferences over the next few months. The first is Consciousness and Contact at the Pine Ridge Reservation in South Dakota, July 18th to the 22nd. I'm going to be there with Yvonne Smith, Alan Steinfeld, Ananda Bosman, Kevin Briggs, and others. It's a small conference, but it is a very interesting one. It's going to include a traditional Lakota feast. I'm going to be talking about ascension and the afterlife based around my book, The Afterlife Revolution. There's going to be a breakfast and a trip to the Wounded Knee Memorial. There will also be a Sundance. Other speakers will be Cindy Ketches, who will provide an overview of Lakota spirituality. Alan Steinfeld, his research on hybrids, remote viewing, developing multidimensional consciousness. Ananda Bosman will be discussing the 432 healing frequency and what it all means. Yvonne Smith will be talking about abductees. There's going to be a lot going on there. If you want to go, call Mia Ferroleto at 802-952-6217 or email her at mia.ferroleto@gmail.com. That's 802-952-6217 for Consciousness and Contact, July 18 to 22 in the Pine Ridge Reservation in South Dakota. Then, on October 4th through the 6th, I'm going to be at the Portal to Ascension Conference in Long Beach, California, and along with a very large number of other guests. It's a big conference. Billy Jackson, JJ and Desiree Hertak, Barbara Lamb, Jason Quitt will be there, Alan Steinfeld again, John D'Souza, Michael Tellinger, Ray Hernandez will be there, Travis Walton will be there. As I say, it's a big conference, October 4th to the 6th at the Atrium Hotel in Irvine, California. Find out more at ascensionconference.com. Listen to some words from one of our longtime subscribers.
As a subscriber of Dreamland for many years, it's been an incredible adventure and truly a Rosetta Stone for so many of the experiences that all of your listeners have had. Please join us. It's a fantastic ride. But I will say that certainly Dreamland does reflect something that I've always known, that man's mind mirrors a universe that mirrors man's mind. And no other place will you get this truth than on Dreamland. Come join us.
Not too many shows get endorsements like that from people who have been with us for years. Join us. Join the fun. Join the adventure. Join the exploration. $4.95 a month, $39.50 a year, 6 month and 3 month subscriptions too. Go to unknowncountry.com, click on the subscribe tab on the upper right, and get aboard. You will not be sorry. It's a great experience to be part of this community.
And we're back with Lance Mangia, and we are talking about his movie, Third Eye Spies, and the remote viewing program that was commissioned and run by the CIA and the armed forces for espionage purposes, and all the strangeness that lies within that murky subject.
Yes.
Hey, just before we the break, you were talking about the sort of the tensions between the departments, and I want to change directions a little bit. When I spoke with Jim Mars, I asked him the question because I sensed it, and I knew because of the books that I had read. I said, you know, I've been reading up on this stuff, and my sense is that some of the people involved in the remote viewing program have had UFO contact. And Jim, was very clear. He cut me off and he said, it's not some, all of them. All of them had some sort of contact experience. And he was specifically talking about the military-trained remote viewers early on in the program. And then there's a wonderful clip of Jacques Vallée on YouTube, and he's talking in front of an audience. And I know he was coming out and speaking openly about the remote viewing program for a few years there. And he said he was called in specifically because of his knowledge of the UFO phenomena. And he, you know, basically concluded that I can't remember how he said it. I'm pretty sure he said all of the people involved in the program have had some sort of UFO contact, and they could trace their remote viewing, let's say the remote viewing gifts, back to those contact experiences. I don't know if you touched on that at all. It wasn't in the movie, but I'm just wondering if you talked about during the process.
I did. I did, and it's a subject that, that fascinates me, you know, personally. And you know, Russell's and my sort of mantra in making the film was one unbelievable thing at a time, and that, you know, like, we needed to establish sort of the validity of the data and the history, and the sort of the reality of remote viewing, you know. And so that was sort of like step one. But in reality, yeah, I mean, you know, some of the pretty much, yeah, every remote viewer I've spoken with has had some sort of encounter at some point, you know, either through remote viewing or elsewise, you know, with.
And one of the, I'm just going to interrupt, one of the elsewise things would be a near-death experience.
Yes. Well, near-death experiences, you know, all of these things. I think that actually the UFO phenomenon and remote viewing are two sides of the same coin. You know, it's the same thing, and it's the same thing that you would find if you were if you just became a deep meditator, you know, or if you got really into you know, DMT or ayahuasca, or, you know, however you access the sort of cosmic internet, you know, you're going to find there's other people on the internet and they're using it too. And I think that what the evidence sort of suggests in this area is that your consciousness can go anywhere, you know, and it doesn't matter how far away it is, any sense of time is irrelevant, you know. So it's just as easy for you to make a phone call to Alpha Centauri as it is to make a call to your friend in the next room and you're trying to read what's on his note card psychically, you know. Like, you know, it's consciousness is the primary thing, like Max Planck said. You know, it is the thing that sort of drives all communication to a certain degree. And it also, the other missing factor here is your imagination, you know, because it's an imaginary skill. You know, remote viewing is simply just the act of closing your eyes and imagining what the first unexpected images you see are, you know, when you're looking at a given target. All you have to know is that the target exists. So if you see a UFO in the sky, that's automatically a proof of existence that to you, it's a permission slip to be able to communicate with your own consciousness. Or if somebody says, here, look at this photo of a UFO, you know, again, you can tap into it because now you have an imaginary doorway to which your consciousness knows that something is there, so you can look at it. And if you ask me, that's probably one of the most interesting things about the remote viewing program, and it's probably the most highly classified thing, you know, the thing that we're probably not supposed to be talking about. Because if I can make a contact with an ET through remote viewing, then I can probably see what the propulsion system of his, you know, ship looks like, if there is one. You know, I can probably draw a sketch of that, and maybe a physicist somewhere might find that really interesting. So, you know, you can just extrapolate out so many things once you sort of acknowledge the fact that something like ESP exists. You know, once you kind of get on board with that, then it opens up this whole sort of magical world of possibilities when it comes to things like extraterrestrial contact, you know, because it's just another aspect of consciousness, another point in sort of space and time that your consciousness can connect to. If you're sort of operating on the same, you know, wavelength as it, you know. So, yeah, I think that's probably why Jacques Vallée was brought in, because a lot of the remote viewers would start to say stuff like, well, gee, I was looking at this target, and then all of a sudden I noticed there was an underground base over here with, you know, UFOs. And what's that all about? You know, like, that actually happened with Pat Price, who was one of the very, very best remote viewers they ever had. You know, he just started seeing UFO stuff and wanted to know more about it. And then Hal Putoff decided to give a call to a base in Alaska near where Hal had said he saw this. And before Hal could even talk about UFOs, the guy says, oh, you mean the area where we see all the UFOs? Yeah, we see UFOs there all the time. You know, so there's something to this. We know that's the case. And the missing link is just our own consciousness and our own sort of permission slips that we sort of need to give ourselves in order to be able to make that contact, in my opinion.
That end of the story really amazes me. And to have someone just say it so straight, two people who were right there say it so straight, and then it just shows up in all the books, you know?
Yeah.
Like, I'm just thinking of Ingo's book, and I'm thinking of it shows up in Joe McMonagle's book, and it certainly shows up in some of the interviews that Lynn Buchanan has done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and all of these people have had some sort of encounter, and again, I would attribute it. I'm sure if you talk to a lifelong meditator who was a Tibetan monk or something like that, maybe they would provide you with different labels, or say a Native American shaman or an Aboriginal or something like that. All of these cultures throughout time have all talked about, star people, have all talked about, making contact with non-physical beings in some capacity, because they start to realize the power of their own consciousness and the fact that it extends really anywhere and everywhere. And when they come to that realization, people start saying hello from other cultures, possibly on other planets, I think that's just part of us being human, is that, we don't recognize our own potential, and that lack of recognition actually holds that potential back because we just not using our imagination enough yet. And we're wasting our time trying to look at radio signals and telescopes and stuff like that.
Yes, I agree. That forced me to tears to think of like the millions of dollars spent on these, listening devices, when I can think of 10 people that I know who certainly seem to have like a direct connection. So like with the great, that end of the great beyond, the one that we picture in flying around a metal spacecraft.
Yeah.
Hey, here, I met Russell Targ. This is going back about probably around 10 years ago. I was at a UFO conference when they were still being held in Laughlin, Nevada. And they're being held there again now, but this was called the International UFO Congress. And Russell gave a talk and he stood on stage, and there's a scene in the movie.
Yeah.
Where there's people and they have their little notebooks, and Russell Targ is standing on stage, and he gives almost word for word the lines I remember him saying. He says something like, picture the first unusual image that pops into your mind.
Yep.
And he said, let's just do it. If you have a piece of paper, let's just draw it. I was a professional illustrator for most of my life. Mm-hmm. And I had a notebook and a pen. I just pulled it out, and he said, okay, you don't know the next slide I'm going to show. You just draw the next slide that I'm going to show. And he just was quiet for a second. I was just like, okay. And I just had this vision in my mind. I had no expectations at all. I just was like, oh, okay, I'll just do this. And I drew, it was really funny because I drew, it felt like a gazebo in a town square,
mm-hmm.
but it's got this, like, I always wanted to say artwork of like swirling metal rose thorns, like the vines of a rose, like a rose bush, all swirling around with their big thorns all projecting out.
Hmm.
And there were these cement benches, and it kind of, these little sidewalks led from it. And I was working as an illustrator, and I did like thousands of storyboards over the years. And I just started putting trees and stuff in, and I don't, and afterwards he shows a slide, and it was the, at Stanford College, there on the campus, there's a piece of artwork, and it's kind of centered in the commons, and it looks like a gazebo, sort of. It's kind of got a cylinder shape, except it's a series of dolphins, metal dolphins, all swirling around. And what the dolphins all have is they have the fins, and the fins all look like, in a way, they look like rose thorns.
Mm-hmm.
And I went up to him after, and it's funny because the day I said, I'd missed this totally. And then I looked at it the next day, and I was like, actually, this is pretty close. And I sat with him for a little bit, and he kind of, has very thick glasses, and he held his glasses in a certain way and looked at my drawing. He says, in his very stoic, slow way that he speaks, he goes, now this is quite good. And we talked about it for a while, and I said, I kind of put the bushes in there, and that's just, I worked as an illustrator, and they were in my mind, and I put those in there. And he said this wonderful line. He said, oh, the demon of the mind.
Yeah. Yes, the demon of the mind. That's exactly it. I mean, it's like, so many times I've heard Russell say, don't label it, don't name it, just draw the first thing that comes to your mind. And so many times people will draw things and they'll have no idea what it is, but then you kind of like turn the paper sideways and it's an exact representation of the target or something like that. It's like, it's just, our consciousness can not only reach out and connect to other, spaces, times, people, things, but it can also really screw ourselves up, because the imagination also works to sort of just give you a whole bunch of junk and tell you kind of like what you want to see. It's like we all have these like filters, and I would actually be willing to bet that the other thing that sort of made your first remote viewing experience easier to grasp is something that actually Lori Williams, who is also in our film, she's a remote viewing instructor. You know, she's had lots of her own, you know, UFO encounters and things like that. But she's runs a company called Intuitive Specialists, and she's great.
Wait a minute, wait just a second. So she's had her own UFO encounters?
Yes. Yes, she has.
Okay. Just go on. I just, when you said that, you said it just like, so like, it was basically like, oh, you know, she walks her dog every day.
Well, yeah, it's, they all tell me these, yeah, everybody has these stories, but it's, the thing is that she says is the secret to being a remote viewing instructor and doing something for the first time is that like what Russell was showing you or the random kind of targets that she'll pick for a class, they're targets that have been remote viewed before, you know, like that, not maybe in the same class, maybe not even for a year, but they're things that other people have looked at psychically before. And it's like that somehow blazes a trail through consciousness and it makes things easier to see. It's like a line from the film. It's like, you know, the more you try to hide something in psychic space, the easier it is to see in psychic space. So when there's a lot of attention focused on something, just makes it easier to see, you know. And I would actually even tout our film's horn a little bit and say that possibly you can extrapolate that out and say, even just featuring remote viewing data in our film or anywhere else you might see it, might have made it easier for the original psychic back in the 70s, somebody like a Hella Hammett or a Pat Price, to latch onto it and to accurately draw it. Because the more consciousness that's focused on it, you know, the more people that are seeing it. You know, our film is out worldwide now. It's on iTunes, it's on Amazon, it's on Google Play. I mean, any cable video on demand channel, you can now get Third Eye Spies. And because of that, it actually kind of breaks down the sort of barriers that make it hard to see those types of things psychically, both moving ahead in time for people trying to do it, and also for people in the past who are looking at targets. And actually, like one of the targets that we used in the film, I didn't include this in the film because it's just too complicated. But when Hella Hammett remote viewed this overpass that's in the film, it was her very first remote viewing. It was just like you. She was sitting down and she was drawing on a piece of paper what she felt she saw. And I have the original audio recording of that. And when you listen to the raw recording, it starts to sound like she's describing Russell Targ walking over the overpass in 2015 versus Hal Puthoff, who was there in 1970, whatever it was, 3 or 4. You know, and she actually says there's an obstruction in the middle of this conduit that he has to kind of go around. And I sunk up the raw audio, and literally Russell had to go around this obstruction in the middle of the overpass that he was walking, because it was a bike, you know, stopper, like, you know, so you can't ride your bike over the overpass. They put this kind of gate there.
Yep. Yep.
And the thing is, that wasn't put in until the 90s. But she said,
"Oh, so the ripples in the pond go not only all around the world; they go back and forward in time." And
exactly. They it's very, very possible that she was actually watching our movie in 2019, or not her literally, but like all of the other consciousness watching that scene may have informed her remote viewing back in 1974, and she died in the 90s. You know, so it's like she's not even alive today to send the information back to herself. But what does that say about the way that sort of consciousness works virally? You know, it's just like the more attention that is focused on something, the easier it is to latch onto.
Hey, I'm sorry, but we're going to need to take a quick break. We're at about the 30-minute mark, and this is the point where we say goodbye to the free Dreamlanders. We've reached the end of the free interview content for non-members. But for members, this is only the halfway mark. We'll be back, and we will continue the interview in just a moment.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From communion to the afterlife revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
Did you know that pet dogs are routinely stolen from their homes in Thailand and smuggled to Vietnam under atrocious conditions, and then slaughtered for food? Worse, the slaughter is brutal because it's believed that it makes the meat taste better. Of course, there are many larger problems in the world, but not to these dogs, and the Soy Dog Foundation is there to help them. Dog has given man everything he has to give, heart, soul, body, and mind. When he calls to us in need, we have to answer. Go to unknowncountry.com and click on the Soy Dog Foundation ad on the left side of the homepage. A $10 gift today can save a dog from this terrible suffering tomorrow. Unknown Country and Whitley Strieber receive no compensation from the Soy Dog Foundation.
We are back. We are talking with Lance Mungia about his film, Third Eye Spies, and the secret history of the government's involvement in remote viewing research. Actually, more than research, they put it into practical use. And we're going to pick up the interview right where it got cut off. And Lance will be talking about our history, our human history, with psychic abilities.
And I think that one of the reasons that psychic abilities were first developed was because, you know, humankind was operating in a very kind of a lonely state interacting with nature. It's like, you know, you weren't surrounded by a bunch of other people. You didn't have any technology. So you had to use your gut. So I think that there is something to be said for sort of putting our phones down at some point and just connecting to sort of the quiet space, you know, because it really is. It's like they say in meditation, it's like that still, quiet, you know, voice within. I think that's where psychic ability really comes from, you know, and any kind of contact or other thing you might want to have, it's never this loud, blaring thing in your head. It's always just an internal knowing. And if we're constantly exposed to all of these electronic kind of technological things, might make it more difficult, I think, to connect on that level.
Yeah. And I would, so you just sort of, you've said enough there. I've got like 12 different questions I want to address here, but I just want to say that I spent a long time teaching in the outdoors and taking people out in the mountains and such like that in small groups. And it, so you said it's kind of a lonely thing to be in the wilderness and, you know, with your tribe.
Yeah.
And I would say exactly the opposite. I would say that it's probably more rewarding than to be in the sort of atomized world we live in now. And I think there would be a mystical connection to the trees and the stars and the water you drink and the food you eat. There would be a mystical connection for all that. So I think that I agree. We need to turn off the Wi-Fi and get out in the mountains more. And for me, there's a very strong mystical connection in that word. And you said something else. I did this little thing. This was years ago. I don't really meditate much. And, mm-hmm. and here's part of the reason why I don't meditate is I went to this little thing and there was this group that was just doing a Sunday meditation. And they were just, there was like, actually it was an empty storefront in this little town I lived in Idaho. And then we just go, and then we sat in a circle, and then, and I'd never meditated before. And this woman said, okay, just, and I kind of said, like, I've never done this before. And then she just gave me this like one sentence little thing, just like, just clear your mind and just, you know, try not to focus on anything. Just, and I had the most powerful mystical experience sitting there. And I have spent the last 25 years trying to get that experience again. And I haven't been able to, which is, that sort of plays in almost to the story I told earlier about having no expectations when it came to drawing what Russell Targ was going to put up on the next slide.
Yeah. Yeah. It could be that, that your powerful experience basically caused you to question, you know, that when doing it again, that happens all of the time. You see it in psychic research where somebody will get a really great first result because there's no expectations whatsoever. And then when they're asked to do it again, they question it so much that statistically they'll get way worse than chance results. And this happened to me. I mean, Russell hands me, you know, his cell phone and hands me his ESP trainer app, which is on iPhone for free. You can get it. And he says, here, try this. And I'm doing it. And I know I'm in the presence of this guy who has spent, you know, decades studying psychic abilities. So the pressure is on and I'm doing it and I'm getting like 3 or 5 out of like 20, you know, which is like way below chance. And I said, well, I guess I'm like the worst psychic in the world, right? And he goes, no. He says, you're actually using your psychic ability to get all of the wrong answers, because you, this expectation that you need to succeed is so strong that you're using reverse psi, you know? So I think that's such a big deal when it comes to this kind of work, is getting out of our own way, you know, just like, you know, like no expectations, no plans. That's actually why when it comes to meditation, I love binaural beats, you know, because binaural beats, you put on the headphones and it just kind of puts you into that zone. And before you know it, you're just in this kind of meditative state, and then you're kind of coming out of it and going, wow, I feel better, or I had some impressions or whatever. But it's just a way of getting out of your own way.
And it's funny, you know, that's what I do use. I do use the binaural beats. I was using, there's an updated version that, the Map of Heaven guy, or the Proof of Heaven, the doctor from that had the near-death experience.
Oh, yes. Evan Alexander?
Eben Alexander, yes. He's been, has a sort of more modernized technical version that was similar to the one that came out of the Monroe Institute. Now, here's a really funny thing. I've talked to people. And I talk to people who have UFO contact all the time and UFO experiences all the time. But the only people I've ever talked to who have used that system, I mean, I'm sure there are people who are out there who have, but the only people I've talked to are all UFO experiencers that use the binaural beat thing, which is a funny little, you know, I don't know quite what to think of that. So,
well, it definitely puts you into, they call it fast food meditation, which I don't really like, but it's kind of like, you know, you don't need to spend the years learning the discipline. You just do it. And there's apps now you can get on your phone. And it could be that if it's, for instance, it's not working for you, the one you're using, you might want to try a different one or a lower frequency or something, because over time your brain habituates to it and you're not getting the same effect. It's much like, you know, you develop a tolerance. You know, and I find, though, too, that my earliest experiences were my best and most profound, but they were also there when I needed them to be. I mean, we talk about synchronicity. Like, I was reading a chapter in your book about remote viewing, and you know, it talks so much about the synchronicity of UFO contact and like these owls, you know, like coming right to you know, two years in a row at the Super Bowl. You know, the owl shows up and gets hit by somebody's car or something. And like, what are the odds of something like that? All of that suggests that we are in this kind of clockwork of the universe in a way that we don't understand. And that when we can kind of let go of our rational minds, we can tap more into the universal mind and pull what we need from it. So it's like you maybe had your mystical experience and I've had mine just at the right times in life that we needed them to be there to kind of put us on our way. And then the rest of the time, maybe it's not as important that we need to have it right now. And so we just haven't had it for whatever reason, because that's synchronicity. That's the way things work.
Well put. Hey, there's two folks in the movie, Hal Putoff and Kit Green, and they were both there at the forefront of this remote viewing study and research and more than research, and they were putting it to use. Those two names have risen up again, and they are part of the To the Stars Academy. And I know that that Hal was on the stage. I'm not sure if Kit Green was on the stage when Tom DeLonge did his little video press release.
No.
Which is going back now, I think, to 2017, the very end of 2017. So very interesting that these guys were at, you know, focused on one thing, you know, 30 years ago, 40 years ago now. And now they're here, they're still in the game and on a completely different, but, you know, as we've noted more than once here, connected subject matter.
Yeah, I did mention that remote viewing and UFOs are kind of two sides of the same coin, right?
Yeah. Yeah, you did.
You know, it seems to me like, well, first of all, when it comes to someone like Kit Green, who you know, was the original CIA contract monitor and later became head of CIA life sciences, and you know, has a interest in this kind of subject matter, I would say. But he's never really in the limelight. You know, he was very hard to even pin down for an interview. Hal's much more public about what he does to a certain extent. But it's very interesting to me that and I don't have any proof of where Hal went after he left the SRI program in the 80s. But I can say that he left at the very height of their program when they were getting a huge influx of cash, you know, to do more experiments. You know, he literally was about to bring Joe McMonagle into SRI at the time. This was in the mid 80s. And Hal literally just kind of in the middle of the night took his files and left and said, that's it, I'm done. with SRI. Now, because he had gotten this offer to start a free energy research lab in Austin, Texas, you know, is the official story, which he still is at today. He's been researching sort of energy from the vacuum and very exotic kind of technologies, including potentially what could be UFO technologies ever since. And when we were doing all of these interviews, he was not talking at all about the UFO subject. But when I would interview other people about both Kit and Hal, which is something that I do as an interviewer, if I'm talking to someone else that knows the person I'm going to interview next, I'll just say, you know, so what's your take on, you know, what Hal's doing or what Kit's doing? And again, it would come up. Oh, I think they're working on something about UFOs. Yeah, they're always talking about UFO stuff. And they weren't talking to me about it as the interviewer, but this came up. And so, you know, when you talk to Hal, you know, about what he does in Austin and eventually on my YouTube channel, which is Waking Universe TV on YouTube, I'm going to have a whole tour of Hal's Austin laboratory where he does his free energy research, because I followed him around for a few days. He was incredibly gracious in letting me videotape him. But he said in 30 years of researching free energy, he has never found someone that truly had energy from the vacuum, you know, that actually had like a cold fusion device or something like that. They've always been able to kind of explain it away. And yet he has written some fantastic papers, which you can find on the International Remote Viewing Association website, on things like anti-gravity, on the potential propulsion systems that a UFO could use to get around, because it's not that they're actually moving super fast. It's that they're bending space-time, you know, things like that. And I got to wonder, just as a layperson, and it's nothing that anyone has actually told me, it's just my own sort of take on this, is why did the remote viewing guy, you know, who had been so incredibly successful in classified government, leave at the height of that success to go study free energy? And then now, decades later, you know, their contract monitor, Kit Green, gets Hal involved in this, you know, sort of UFO study program run by Robert Bigelow, you know, who has a long-term interest in this kind of subject matter and also had a long-term interest in working with Hal, you know, because he was one of his, I think, supporters there at his lab. So I think the answer is in remote viewing. You know, I think it's pretty obvious that people like Joe McMonagle, Jacques Vallée, others have all talked about the fact that, you know, when you want to know about a UFO, go to a remote viewer and have the remote viewer look at it. I just the other day saw a talk that Joe McMonagle did about being tasked to look at a very specific UFO target. And he said that every time this would randomly come up over a period of months, like his wife would just task him without telling him about this UFO that he was supposed to look at. And every time he would just get like a Y symbol and like, you know, a series of boxes within boxes. And it was as if he was being blocked from the target, that he couldn't see it. You know, well, that's in that instance. But he's also talked in other instances about being able to draw diagrams of propulsion systems and sort of give descriptions of things that were going on inside UFOs when he's working for the Army. So I think this is something that is probably being done. I don't know how you would verify something like that. But if you have great remote viewers who are really good at seeing everything else and that they're incredibly reliable and they're coming back to you with information about UFO technology or something like that, and you're a physicist and you maybe know a lot about technology that even that remote viewer would know nothing about, maybe something that the remote viewer says makes a lot of sense and you're able to incorporate that into other research that you're doing, and somebody within the halls of government gets really happy about it because you get a breakthrough.
Yeah. Hey, I've worked on some films. I worked in the film industry ages ago, mostly TV commercials, but I've worked on documentary stuff a little bit. And so I know what it means at the end of the day to all go to the restaurant together. What was that like? Like just hanging out, talking shop with these guys?
Oh, it was awesome. The best, though, the very best was one of the most gracious people we interviewed, which was Ken Kress, you know, again, who was the sort of undercover CIA, you know, program.
Which is a name I had never heard before. And I feel like I got a pretty good working knowledge of this. Yeah.
Yeah. He invited us to his home outside of Yellowstone in Montana for like a week, you know, and I spent an entire week with his wife, and he gave me this wonderful tour of Yellowstone. And I was able to film as a fly on the wall, like these dinners at his home, especially when Russell came out and joined us. It was fascinating. It was like watching this like 30-year-old chess game take place, because you could tell that like both of them didn't really 100% trust each other, because Ken, even though he had been intricately involved in all of these experiments and even operational work, he could never, it had been on his mind for decades as to like how all of this got started and how all of it worked. And you could see him kind of probing Russell over dinner, and you could see Russell kind of like going back over him. And then the wine starts flowing, and they're just like telling these old stories about stuff. And, but what's so interesting is anytime I think you deal with covert stuff, what was so interesting was that there was so much that both of them did not know after even 30 years or 40 years of not talking. You know, like there were new things that would come up, and Russell would say, "Oh, I didn't know that Sidney Gottlieb had turned you on to, you know, to come and talk to us. And I didn't know about this." And then, you know, like, and Ken would say, "Oh, I didn't know that Kit Green was the one that first recommended you to me," or whatever. You know, there was just so many fascinating things that come up. And through all of those experiences, sort of behind the scenes of making this film, it just became really obvious to me how compartmentalized all of these people have been. You know, even though a lot of them are friends and whatnot, they don't always talk about this stuff. And there's just so much in their own little world that maybe because once it was covert, they just kind of keep it to themselves. And this was really an opportunity to kind of get more stuff out in the open over a few beers or something. You know, and I had that experience many times.
Wow, that's exciting. I mean, so I suspect there's a way that like, I mean, two spies talk to each other, you know, years later. I mean, there must be.
Yeah, there is. And I saw it again and again. And I saw it with Hal and Russell. I saw it with Kit Green. I saw it with, Ken and Russell, you know, where it's like they're always probing, and they're always kind of trying to figure out like what's OK to talk about and what's not. You know, because they could very easily say something they're not supposed to say, and especially when there's a camera in the room, you know, and the trick is kind of just staying in the background and being the fly on the wall and not interjecting or talking and acting very innocent and just letting the camera kind of roll. And then after a while, you know, they kind of don't even think about the camera, and they're just doing their thing. And, you know, I saw that happen so many times, and some of the best stuff I got actually was over dinner or, you know, at lunch or something like that. You know, it's just, it really was an interesting way of doing this film.
Yeah, this is so strange. So there's a fellow named Jim Semivan. He's involved in the To the Stars thing. He wrote the foreword to one of Tom DeLonge's book. I think it was the fiction book.
Hi, this is Mike. I am chiming in once again during the editing. I was trying to remember the book that Jim Semivan wrote the foreword to. I got a little muddled and mixed up, and I was referencing a different book. And I had to sort of backpedal, and both Lance and I were laughing, and it was – so anyway, you don't get to hear any of that. But I want to point out that a member of the To the Stars Academy wrote the foreword to Tom DeLonge's 2017 book titled Secret Machines Chasing Shadows. I think this was only for the paperback edition in 2017, but I want to read that. The author of the book is Tom DeLonge and A.J. Hartley. I suspect A.J. Hartley did a lot of the writing, but the foreword is interesting. And this is coming from a guy named Jim Semivan, and here's his bio. I'll read it. Jim Semivan retired in 2007 after a 25-year career in the Central Intelligence Agency's National Clandestine Service. At the time of his retirement, he was a member of the CIA's Senior Intelligence Service. Okay, now here's a guy who's writing a foreword to a book about UFOs written by a guy who plays guitar in a punk rock band. And this is just a short excerpt. Those on the journey recognize the path. As for my formal introduction to the phenomena, as we know it in today's context, it came suddenly and unexpectedly. I will not attempt to go into the experience here, but I will say that it was one of life's game changers for both my wife and me. The experience was simultaneously frightening, perplexing, frustrating, and absurd. It was also both physical and emotional, although I am undecided as to whether there was any spiritual addendum. Almost 30 years later, I am still not sure what to make of the experience. What I do know, however, is that this event changed my view of what constitutes our collective version of reality.
That's some pretty strong stuff coming from a guy with that kind of resume. And he's obviously parsing his words carefully. But to me, it sure sounds like he is describing his own experience of first-hand UFO contact, without saying it as clearly as I just said it there. I thought that was very interesting, and I thought it was worthwhile to include it here. Okay, back to the interview. So one more example of this overlap.
Yeah, there's a lot of it, because I think that it's kind of like you need something that you experience personally to kind of get into this kind of a subject matter. I can tell you about remote viewing all day long. You can tell me about UFOs all day long. But it doesn't really sink in unless you get some sort of firsthand experience. That's why in the remote viewing programs, they would get tons and tons of high-ranking people in government that would come through their laboratories and want to see a proof of remote viewing, because they would think they were being fleeced out of their money. And instead of sitting down Pat Price or Ingo Swann or someone like that, they would ask the government official to sit down in the chair and become the remote viewer. You know, and they did this again and again, and they made converts out of a lot of people this way, because it allowed them to experience the phenomenon, see that it wasn't scary, see that it was real. And I think it's the same thing with the UFO experience. And again, I keep going back to the fact that even contact, you know, something like we talk about disclosure and these other things as if there's some distant thing. But it might just be as easy as you sitting down and deciding you want to make contact. And then if you do, then it's a question of, are you grounded enough and balanced enough that you're not going to get carried away with this and go into crazy land? Because you can do that too, whether it's with remote viewing or UFOs.
Yes, very much so. I've been in crazy land a little bit in my life. So
yeah, so have I. I mean, I think we all have. If anybody that's had these kinds of experiences, and you have to step back and say, I am going to remain discerning. I'm going to remain grounded. I have enough discipline in my life in some other area. I'm successful at something else. I'm good at what I do. So I'm able to use my own discernment and then make sense of this, even when it doesn't make any sense. Like if you see a gray in front of you, or if you see a UFO in the sky, or if you're perfectly drawing something that you're an airport where your partner is hiding at halfway around the world and you have no idea. Those are all things that completely rearrange your sense of reality, you know, and they're life-changing things. And that is the other thing that I really took from making this film, whether it was Russell or three or four dozen other people that I interviewed, all of them came away changed, you know, through their experiences with remote viewing, because it opened up their world in ways that they initially didn't understand. And so they had to rearrange their worldview because of it. And actually, I think it made them all better people. You know, and if there's something that we can kind of take away from all of this, it's that we're all connected in some way, you know, and in fact, we're a lot more connected than we actually give ourselves credit for.
I mean, I often say, like, I've been confronted with this stuff in my life, and people say, like, you know, well, what is it like? And I say, I live in a magical universe,
mm-hmm.
You know, like I can't answer. I don't know how these things happen. I don't know how the synchronicities happen. I don't know where the UFOs come from. I don't know the mystical reason of the owl, but I know that from me, this mere mortal, it appears as magic, and I'm content with that word. So like I live in a magical universe, and a lot of people don't, and I feel really blessed I do.
Yeah. And that's too bad, because I think that, you know, Dean Radin wrote a book called Real Magic, I think, which is great. But it's always about what we don't understand that makes the world interesting, right? If I knew everything, if I had all of the answers, you know, if I could see around every corner, what fun would life be? You know, there's no mystery. And science, or spirituality for that matter, should be about what we don't know. You know, it's the leap of faith that we have to take to get to the next step, you know, in whatever we're doing. And I think that part of the problem with where we're at in the West, at least with science, is that we're so close-minded to anything that is not already perfectly understood. And you can't come up with a working hypothesis for something like a UFO or an ET encounter or even remote viewing, because all of those things, I really believe, are intricately linked to consciousness. You know, and that's the missing link. And you can't pin that down. You can't say, you know, describe to me how this exactly works so that I can repeat it in a scientific setting and then make it happen exactly the same way. And because we can't do that, you know, it's not taken as seriously as a scientific study, even when you can see phenomenon all day long. I mean, there's not a doubt at all that we are being visited by something, you know, from somewhere, or that something like psychic abilities are real. It's not in doubt. I mean, as there's 100 years of data you can go back and look at. There's more efficacy for psychic ability than there is aspirin. You know, according to Jessica Utz, who's in our films, who's the head of the American Statistical Society, and she looked at all that data over 100 years, looking at every single laboratory, and found that there is more evidence for psychic ability than there is for aspirin. But with aspirin, there's a scientific, you know, hypothesis on why aspirin works, and there is not for one on remote viewing, because you're never going to find it in the material world, because it isn't a material thing. It's imaginal, you know.
And that's the role of the artist. I mean, you are in a creative process. You are not a scientist. You're a filmmaker. And thank God you've made this movie in that sense, because you could, you know, you could wrestle with these ideas of science and stuff like that, but you didn't have to present it as science. You were presenting it as a story.
Yes. And that's
which I found I could get swept away in.
Thank you. Thank you for that. And it's so true. I get to spout off about all kinds of stuff because I don't have a PhD. You know, if you talk to somebody like Russell, he doesn't speculate about things that he can't actually see, because and he'll actually say, you know, he gets mad when somebody says, do you believe in ESP? Because he says, I don't believe in ESP any more than I have to believe in a laser. If I turn the laser on, I see an effect. I know that the laser is real. Same thing with ESP. It just is or it isn't, you know, but he won't speculate about a lot of other stuff because he's a scientist. You have to go into the realm of almost poetry to really wrap your head around something as vast as consciousness and our own place in the universe, because it's one of the things I loved about Stephen Schwartz. He's on our film and was also a kind of a pioneer of the remote viewing world, but he's also a philosopher. You know, and you know, he said, you know, if you're going to accept the reality of the work that was done at SRI and other laboratories with remote viewing, then you have to accept that, you know, we don't just live on the planet. We don't just live in the biosphere. We are the biosphere. We are intricately linked to the entire planet. And I'll go even a step further and say we're linked to everything, you know, and that's a very esoteric statement that would come out of some spiritual text, you know, written 2,000-3,000 years ago or more, but
or from Bashar, you know, last weekend at some seminar that he sat on a stage, he would say the same thing. Yeah,
that's right. He does, and any of the sort of philosophers, even channelers, etc., they're all saying the same thing, you know, which is wake up, everybody, you know, because you are, you know, it, you know, we are all connected in a way, you know, that we're basically as big as we can possibly imagine. And the way into that is not by using your ego or becoming ungrounded. It's actually being more grounded, you know, and more sort of centered and more calm and going into that kind of very still, quiet place where we have access to all of those things.
Lance, I want to thank you so much. This has been great. This has been just great. I probably went a little over as far as time, but I think that's going to be just fine. This has been a great interview, and I would love to talk to you more at some point.
Yeah, me too. I would love to keep the conversation going. You know, I'm definitely going to be doing another project soon, and I'm hoping to combine, you know, to talk a lot about these things with the UFO phenomenon that a lot of these remote viewers wanted to talk about, but that we needed to get across sort of the phase one of this, which is, guess what? You know, psychic abilities are actually real. There is some real phenomenon here worthy of true discussion. And so, you know, I really hope to continue to do this kind of work. And please, if you haven't seen my film yet and you're listening to this podcast, please go see Third Eye Spies. Tell a friend about it. Tell 10 friends about it, please, because that's how we're going to be able to keep doing this kind of work. And you know, you're helping me as a filmmaker to, you know, go out into the world and make some interesting stuff that otherwise I don't think I would be able to make. So I'm really grateful.
Great. And what's your YouTube channel and what's your, like your contact point online?
Sure. The YouTube channel is youtube.com /WakingUniverseTV. Or you can just type my name into the search on YouTube, which is Lance Mungia, M-U-N-G-I-A. And you can find us on Facebook. You can find us on ThirdEyeSpies.com. And there's a contact form right there. If you want to reach out to me, you can just fill out the contact form. And from ThirdEyeSpies.com, you can get to, iTunes and Amazon, and you can buy DVDs there. All that kind of stuff is right there on ThirdEyeSpies.com. So there's lots of places you can see the film right now. We've been trending well for the first month. We've been in the top 10 or so, kind of jumping back and forth on iTunes, but not a lot of people have seen the film yet in the grand scheme of things. And, I spent a long time on this. I really want people to see this film, and I hope that you'll enjoy it. And if you do, please write a review, because that's how a lot of people find it. And Mike, just thank you so much for your time, giving me the time to talk.
Oh, this has been great. Yeah. And I wish you the greatest success in this thing. And I also think, honestly, it's good that there's successful UFO documentaries out there, successful, serious UFO. I mean, I can sense they're popular, and there's been other ones out there. And I hope the trend continues, because thoughtful people doing thoughtful, artistic investigatory work, we're all going to benefit. And it's enjoyable and informative. Yeah,
we do. And I think it also, in general, makes the sort of questions that I think we're both thinking about more accessible to other people. And thus the answers become more accessible, to us all personally, because I think, all of this stuff, you have to come to your own conclusions. And I think that having it out there in the ethers kind of floating around, it really helps. And it's going to help with, I think, new creative and inspirational work that's going to come out, and I'm looking forward to that too, seeing what other people come up with.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mike. I appreciate it.
Bye now.
Bye-bye.
Remote viewing and UFO contact. These are different sides of the same coin. That was said more than once by Lance during this interview, and I find that to be really curious, given the fact that he had just spent several years in close cooperation, working closely with a crew of remote viewers that date back almost 40 years in their secret work with the government. To me, that's fascinating. I need to thank Lauren Cutts for his intro music, and Andrea Villiers on the gong. A few points during this audio interview. I used the gong as a sort of bumper, just to separate things a little bit. Hopefully that wasn't too much. If it was, somebody out there please tell me. I thought it sounded great. I live in a house with a lot of gongs. Andrea has some beautiful, remarkable gongs here in the living room, and it was just too tempting not to stick them in here somehow. They sound beautiful. If you've made it this far, thank you so much. Bye now. 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 Much. Bye now.